Thank you.
Is Alfiee in the room yet?
Yeah. Where is she? Oh, there she is. Thank you, Dr. Alfiee, for being here, for giving us the space and time. Your audio, I'm sure, is fine. We're gonna we're gonna start letting people in and just play some music, and we're probably gonna start going like 5 minutes into it or so. Okay, cool. Thank you. I'm gonna mute you, and then we'll. Okay.
Waiting for surprise to see the heaven in your eyes is not so far, and I'm not afraid to try and go with a loveliness and beauty never known before. I'll leave it up to you to show it. And golden lady, I'd like to go there. Golden lady, my golden lady, I'd like to go there. Take me right away. Away, yeah. Looking at your hands, and you know hands can understand. And I'm waiting, waiting for the dance, baby, just to hold your hand. A touch of rain and sunshine made the flower grow into a lovely smile. It's blooming. And it appears to me that you're my dream come true. There is no way that I'll be choosing. Oh, my golden lady, golden lady, I'd like to go there. Oh, golden lady, I'd like to go there. Take me right away. Church on Sunday morning, Grandma's hand played a tambourine so well. Grandma's hand
used to issue out a warning. She'd say, Billy, don't you run so fast. Might fall on a piece of glass. Might be snakes there in that grass, Grandma's hand. Grandma's hand. Soothe the local unwed mother. Grandma's hand. Used to ache sometimes and swell. Grandma's hand. Used to lift her face and tell her she'd say, baby, Grandma, understand that you really love that man. Put yourself in Jesus' hands, Grandma's hand. Grandma's hand.
Hey guys, we're gonna be, perhaps we're gonna wait till some people come in, but we're gonna get going because we do record this. And we also know there's some breaking news about Trump.
Oh yeah, what's going, yeah. Hey. What's going on? Yeah.
Trump's taxes, you know. So for everyone watching this, this is The Other America. We do these bi-weekly. And yes, we do them live on Zoom, but we record them and share them with our community. And it's a space where we can have discussion and hold space for each other as we move towards solutions around police brutality, social injustice, and racism. And we have different themes every single time we have these. We've done everything from the LGBTQ plus community, what's happening in Atlanta, what's happening in Portland. What else, James? I mean, it's been a whole gamut, mental health.
Yeah, Reverend John Lewis, Reverend C.T. Vivian. We've done a lot of things on here. It's been really great to hold this space. We recognize weekends are busy. Shira and I are also talking about moving the date of this so we can accommodate more people, more time zones. As Shira mentioned, it is recorded, so we send this out to hundreds of people that actually end up seeing it, but we'd love for more synchronous folks to be able to catch it, and so we can create real community. We also do have a WhatsApp community for those who enjoy kind of this kind of dialogue. But yeah, we've done a lot, right, Shira? It's been good.
Yeah, it has. So I want to get right into it because I know that we are taking time from individuals that are very busy and that were nice enough to join us.
Yes,
today.
Thank you.
So I want to, one, say hi to Nzinga Blake, who's joining as a co-host today.
Hello.
Hi. So Nzinga is, and I'll spotlight you, is Emmy award-winning producer and journalist. We've done some specials right here with Peace Inside Live. Allies Check-In?
Allies Check-In, yes.
And Nzinga, do you want to say anything as we get into this today?
Well, I'm really excited about the speakers today. As we're getting closer and closer to the election, it's very important that we have these kinds of conversations because, the news does cover what is happening. They don't have enough time to cover why it's happening. So that's why it's really very important for us to hold these kinds of conversations with community, people in our communities, so we can kind of get a sense of what's going on, especially, getting to highlight experts that will be speaking with us today. So I'm really, really happy and excited about today's speakers, especially since one of them is my father.
Yes, you might have noticed that there was another Blake here. That is Dr. Blake. So I'll introduce our guest today. And once again, we are an intimate group today. So let's make sure we open up the conversation. Like, this, once again, let's just be here to talk, hold space for each other. And everyone joining us today is coming from a different place in this space. And so I'll start with Dr. Blake, since that is your father and you kind of like introduced that. So I'm gonna spotlight Dr. Blake. Hello, Professor Blake. How are you?
Good afternoon. Fine, thank you. How are you?
Oh, good evening. Good. I want to just introduce you because you've done so much, formerly of the Department of Africana Studies and the Department of Communication at the University of Pittsburgh in Pennsylvania, served as chair of the Africana Studies Department for 5 years. He's taught at Howard University, Indiana University, State University of New York, and the University of Nebraska. He once served as a senior official at the United Nations University in Tokyo, Japan, and served as Minister of Information and Broadcasting and Chief Government Spokesman in Sierra Leone. He's authored several journal articles and books focusing on communication as well as African development. And I think where the entryway into this conversation as well was how he established the Institute for the Study of Alternative African Futures, located in Sierra Leone, against the background of challenges faced by fractured communities and emerging post-conflict states, increasingly sprawling ghetto communities in African states, the need for consolidating peace. And I think that was where, you know, me and Nzinga started talking about this and what her father was doing and just how important what his work, how it can possibly impact how we're looking at what's happening here and the importance of having that that point of view. So thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you very much for having me.
Okay, I wanna go to Dr. Alfiee, who's a mental health expert who I love. I mean, I wish she was by my side daily. She's also the founder of the mental health nonprofit, the Aakoma Project, and which I hope she talks about here because it's they're doing amazing things. Couched in Color is her podcast as well. She is everywhere and I definitely look up to her. So thank you so much for being here.
My pleasure, my pleasure.
Finally, whereas Kelly Jackson is here, who I just recently met through Facebook. So this is our first time actually seeing each other face to face through Zoom. Modern day. She's a passionate mother fighting for the equality and education of those that don't understand the complexities of systemic racism. She's the creator and founder of Allies for Black Americans, as well as Black Allies for America. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me. I am humbled, to say the least, to be among such esteemed participants and speakers today. So I appreciate the honor. Thank you.
Well, thank you for being here. Yeah. So I want to just one start off with kind of a check-in, since this week is just was crazy, very heavy between Breonna Taylor, the verdict there, what continues to go on in our country and our society leading up to the election. And so because we are an intimate crowd, I would love to hear from everyone how they're doing, if they want to bring up anything that came up for them this week.
And not to mention RBG. I mean,
then the week before, yeah. And of course,
so we've got a lot. And everything that's going on and everything that will go on, even as we sit here now, breaking news is happening. And so, you know, we really wanted to create this space to, you know, less program and more create opportunities for us to talk. So yes, on that note, if someone wouldn't mind checking in and letting us know where you are, where things sit for you.
Does anyone want to speak or one of our guests?
Yeah.
I tend to go with respecting the people who paved the path for me. So I'm sitting here quiet because I want to hear from Dr. Blake, because I wouldn't be here, seriously, if there were not a Dr. Blake who blazed the path. Dr. Blake, I tease that I'm a recovering academic. So I spent about 18 years in academia and I had to get out. I couldn't do it anymore. And so you laugh because you know. So with all due respect, I say ashe to Dr. Blake. And I just, you know, I don't want to put him on the spot, but I really do like to sit back and hear the wisdom of the people who, you know, blazed that path before me. I think about my own dad. My dad is 78. And so I'm always like, Daddy, what do you think? I'm sure with this breaking news, I haven't heard it yet, but that's why I'm quiet, because I'm waiting to hear from the wisdom of, right, like a king.
Well, and Dr. Blake, I mean, you're here in town for a bit and you go in and out of the US. What is your take on everything that's happening right now?
There's one word that dominates the scene right now, and that word is scary. Believe me, And what do I mean by that? I've been in the United States in and out since 1968. I was here during the civil rights struggles, and I was extremely active in the civil rights struggle. And I have seen blatant racism, experienced it a bit while I was at Carbondale, Illinois. And through my teaching, I tried to see how best we could incorporate into the curriculum aspects of understanding what this scourge is all about. And it's not just, the manner we tend to look at it, the manner I tend to look at it, is not just from the perspective of the experience of the United States. I look at it in a very holistic way. I look at it from the lenses of the Caribbean. So I'll spend a lot of time teaching about Brazil, what happened with the Black community, the kind of systemic racism that existed in Brazil, and how difficult it is to unleash, you know. And then you look at the United States. This is a country that is so deeply, deeply, deeply rooted in racist structures, racist ideologies. I don't think we should be hesitant in saying that. And so this is a scary moment, because it seems as if we've not moved from what was going on 20 years ago, 21 years ago, 25 years ago. In fact, the kinds of problems that we're seeing right now at the highest level of governance, at the highest levels of legislation, and now the Supreme Court, it seems as if we are just going backwards. This is what makes me extremely scared for this country, very scared. And if people don't really rise up, I'm not talking about violence, you know, I'm talking about using the rights that people have to effectuate change. We have those rights now, right now. I don't know what is going to happen 4 months from now, depending on the outcome of the elections and with the makeup of the United States Supreme Court, the extent to which these rights will be subverted, you know, we don't know, but it's a scary time. And interestingly, Dr. Alfiee, I heard you talk about your experiences in the academy. We went through very scary times in the academy as well. I remember when I started teaching at the State University of New York, there were two of us who were Black faculty members. One of them was the chairman. And we used to get very racist literature in our boxes, in our mailboxes. You know, we were not supposed to be intelligent. We were not supposed to be able to analyze issues, particularly issues of this nature. And so whenever we got to it, we received terrible racist type of literature. And this was in the mid 70s. And here we are, with insidious genocide going on. So this is why I use the word scary. And I like the inclusion of the word mental, the mental states in this panel, because look, as a people, this has been our struggle. Remember, we were 3/5 of a human being. We were 3/5 of a human being. And to think that the system does not realize what this kind of tension, this kind of division could lead to, I assert to you that this thought went as far back as Thomas Jefferson. He wrote a book called Notes on the States of Virginia. And there's a section in that book in which he really stated that he was scared because the recollections of slavery, the evil things that were meted out to Black people, all these things, that they may come and take retribution. They will attack them. So we did have slave revolts and things like that, but nothing systematic in terms of dealing with these kinds of fears. So the proselytization of fear of Black people, this is something that has a long history, manifested in lynching, manifested right now in the kinds of things we're seeing in the streets of the United States. You're working on the streets as a Black person in some communities, and there is somebody coming, you know, from a Caucasian coming. There is fear, they cross the street. You go into stores. Until today, I thought that was really waning. We are still being followed in stores. So this element of fear, you see it now being proselytized heavily towards the elections. Watch your neighborhoods. Suburbia, watch your neighborhoods. They are coming. So this consistent trope is destabilizing people. And what I fear may happen is that some people may get so laxed about it, or say, you know, this is deja vu, they don't want to take action. And with the media, for example, reporting that, well, these two candidates, you know, they are not liked by people, et cetera, et cetera. This may dissuade some people from voting. And I respect the media. I teach the media. I was responsible for the media in government. And so I would not say that the media should be muted. I would never believe in that. It's not the enemy of the people. But I think the media should be guarded in the manner in which they shape the agenda, the manner in which they try to let people either see the importance of the vote or just withdrawal because of, you know, disinterested. So the long and short of it is this, that we are in an era in which if we are not careful, we would allow fear not to let us exercise our rights. And it is a mental situation that needs to be addressed, and rather quickly. Not to cure it right now, but to sensitize people, to let people realize that this is going on. You cannot continue this way. You have to take action. You have the power to effectuate some change. And this is why these conversations are important, to come from it from various perspectives. And I hope to learn a lot today to see how people are responding to these kinds of things. So for now, this is all I want to say for now.
Dr. Blake, thank you so much for that. It's powerful. It's overwhelming because it can make you feel like, is there hope? Like, it feels overwhelming, I think, for a lot of people. And I know I'm not alone if anyone wants to speak up on that. Yeah, oh, Kelly Jackson, yes. Unmute yourself, there you go.
Okay. Gosh, thank you so much, Dr. Blake. You bring up so many valid points, and I appreciate your time today and the time that you've put into this movement and all of your education to provide us with information that is useful for us in our movement going forward. I have to be transparent, just because I don't know how to be any other way. I'm very emotional today. Our group had a retreat yesterday for about 8 hours to kind of go over how we're going to move forward with our group. And the frustration, and the lack of, like, sometimes I have to tell myself, are you crazy? What are you doing, girl? This opportunity with COVID and everything else, after George Floyd passed, I sat in my room and probably cried for about a week. I have a 17-year-old and a 15-year-old who, my 17-year-old is just now driving, bought herself a car. My 15-year-old will be driving soon. And the fear and the anxiety that I experience, it was already present, but after George Floyd, I don't know if it was something about him calling to his mother really triggered something inside of me. And after I cried for about a week, I said, I can't really live in good conscience if I don't do something actively every day to make sure that I attempt to make this world a safer place, not just for my own children, but other children of color. This system that's been built is really a sick, it's like a sick science experiment or something that's just not been able to be dismantled. So when you say hope, I sometimes am so frustrated that people don't see, aren't willing to see, or choose to be complacent or live in willful ignorance. Because they're not comfortable in giving up the privilege that they have. A privilege that everybody deserves, not just one group of people. So I hope every day. If I don't have hope, I can't move forward in this movement. The reason I created Allies for Black Americans, because I knew in my heart, I am biracial, and I understand that white people are just as traumatized as our Black people, just in a different way. They've been lied to, they've been conditioned, they've been in a situation where they've been taught to continue this cycle through no awareness of their own. Some people, and I say this often, some allies are like, oh, I don't see color. And I don't ever debate that, because I do think that there are people that try to, teach their children to be loving to everyone. I think the part that we're missing is that in teaching your children to be kind to everybody, also make sure you teach your children that there is a group of people that don't have the same equality, the same access to education, the same anything that you do. I had an ally ask me the other day, my son came home and asked me if it was okay that he was happy that he was white. And that was deep to me because I told her, your son realizes something's not right. He has to realize something's not right to recognize that him feeling happy about something is making him uncomfortable. I think if we can get allies to be comfortable in the uncomfortability and get them to a point where it's not personal per se, it is something that needs to be learned, just like you learn specific courses for whatever field you're going to be into. These are courses of life. These are courses of living in a society amongst one another. I hope, I have started a new group, and I will wrap up because I'd love to hear from everybody else. I started a new group, Black Allies for America. I think that having a space for allies to be able to, have insight to our Black experience is something allies don't often get a chance to do. They have Black friends or what have you, but to really hear things like we're talking about today and understand where we're coming from, I think makes us a lot more human to them. And so the importance of that is really for them to see us as humans first. And once they can see us as humans, then they can recognize that there's work to be done on behalf of all of humanity. It's not just for us, it benefits everybody in the broader scope of things. So I recognize that, our Black voices need to have a separate and safe space to be able to speak amongst ourselves, because we have a lot of healing and education to do, to be successful and to break this generational curse and trauma that follows us and plagues us every day. Nobody should be living like this. And we take it every day, and we are strong, and we've been going through this for years, and it's time to stop. Time to stop it. It's enough. That's all I have to say. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Kelly, for being here. And I know you didn't have to be here today, and because it is an energy drain. And so I recognize that. Thank you. I acknowledge you.
Thank you, Kelly.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We have a lot of people, a few people have joined. So I want to just kind of recap what's happening here and just set it up, like reintroduce everyone. So, you know, the Other America is a virtual town hall we do bi-monthly, but to in light of so many things happening, we really wanted to do this one. I mean, it is an intimate group to hold space for each other, to have healing, to discuss anti-racism and moving forward as we move towards the election. We have some amazing guests, as you heard speak, Kelly Jackson, the founder of Allies for Black Americans and now Black Allies for America. We have Dr. Alfiee, a mental health expert, also the founder of the mental health nonprofit, the Aakoma Project. And also has a podcast Couched in Color. We also have Dr. Blake, who's incredible. I mean, I could spend like 30 minutes describing his background, but really has been a professor working at the University of Pittsburgh in Pennsylvania, to Howard University, Indiana University, State University of New York, University of Nebraska, really focusing on Africana studies and also communication, and specifically really like, how do you deal with conflict as and consolidating peace, which is something we get to figure out and work towards. So thank you so much to everyone for joining us and giving us your time on this Sunday as we continue to come together to provide a space for healing and sharing knowledge and moving this forward so we can end what is happening. And we do have the hope, even though it does feel like sometimes we can't. James Andrews also is my co-host here, if you want to say hi or continue the conversation.
No, it's good. No, this was important. I think, you know, Shira and I were talking about this week coming up, and, you know, I think the idea of just holding space to have this discussion was something that, you know, I know we both felt really strongly about. You know, for those of you that have been with us on this journey, we've been doing kind of more programmatic stuff. You know, I think it's just important just to talk. And, you know, I love to say, and I, you know, we want folks, white, black, yellow, Puerto Rican, and Haitian to be involved in this struggle. You know, I've been pretty critical on the word allies because I feel it's a little weak and a little light. No disrespect to those of you that have organizations called allies. I respect that. But I guess the underpinning of that is I'm looking for, you know, for me and my community, I'm looking for partners, and I'm looking for folks that are really in the trenches with us. And so that's really just how I'm feeling this week is I want to hold spaces, and I want to be able to use our gifts to create spaces, and I want to have, you know, conversations that go beyond conversations, and for us to really be connected. So we've set up, you know, the WhatsApp group. We set up things to be able to do that. Shira and I are also going to be just opening a space, you know, as we do some planning for the next 30 days. We're really well aware that the next 30 days will become only more stressful. There is a war, there is a white supremacist war. I work in the hacker community. I know what's going on. So we wanna be realistic, you know, that the times will get more stressful and the need for community will be greater. And so I'm looking for comrades, conspirators, and homies to fight this war. And so I'm just thankful for all of you that you take time and you continue, because you give me hope and inspiration around what it would look like on this rocket ship to Wakanda to look diverse and to know that we have a tribe. So I'm really thankful.
And we're not going to take too much. We're going to do this till like 5:30 today, max. So another or an 5:30, an hour and a half. So we also I want to get to Dr. Alfiee. Do we want to just take three breaths, because I think that
Yeah, we went straight into it. I felt like that was a lot. We probably should, Shira.
Yeah, as we, now that a bunch of people are here, let's take three breaths together and just sitting up straight, getting grounded in our seats and our feet on the floor as we get into, you know, a conversation that isn't easy, but with the intention towards love and change. So just let's take three deep breaths together. Hold it and let it out. Two more. Let it out. One more. Let it out. Just shake it out. Whew. If you need to make some noise wherever you are, you're on mute. I'm not, so I'll just do that for you. And now Dr. Alfiee, I wanna go to who is our mental health expert. And by the way, we do this and we bring some healing into it and mindfulness because we do think in order to really move forward, we need to incorporate that self-love and self-care into our work individually and as a community. I know that's important to you, Dr. Alfiee. As someone who is dealing with this daily, I mean, even taking your time to be on a live stream earlier today and this, and you are a Black woman who is still a human, right? But you're an expert, quote unquote. How do you take time for others and hold space for others and then give that to yourself right now?
A couple things. I want to honor my colleagues who've spoken before me, all of you. There's something that each of you said that really touched me. Dr. Blake, Howard University, HU, I'm Bison through and through. That's going to be my home forever. I love HU. And yes, I donate. People always say that about HBCUs. Yes, I do donate. And Kelly, with the work that you do, I say, Ashe, it's hard work. I'm glad that we have you to do it because that kind of work that you do, I can't do that kind of work. It's not my expertise. And I honor that you are willing to hold space to allow people space to be educated and to help bring them along and to teach them skills. And James, you over there quoting my favorite Tribe Called Quest. I saw you. I was like, yes, those are my boys. I love them. You know, rest in peace, Fife. And of course, Shira, my love, she's just a bright light. She's an amazing woman. We've come so far since we met each other. I can't believe it's been just a year. But like from the first time we met, you're just a wonderful, just a beautiful human. So I appreciate each one of you. And I think that one of the things it's important to, for me, to acknowledge and recognize, one of the ways I take care of myself in addition to daily meditation is recognizing that I'm not obligated to hold space for things that don't serve me. And I am learning that if it doesn't serve me, I have a right and a responsibility to let it go. And I'm learning that things like the phrasing and the trauma, I'm going back to Dr. Blake, the ways in which people communicate about Black people. And I say Black deliberately because there's a diaspora and we come from so many different places, Black Latinx, the continent, the Caribbean, what I call traditionally what I think of as African Americans, the people who were brought here to this continent, to the United States, let me say it like that, what became the United States. Because there's so many different ways you can slice it. And those ships went a lot of places. They did not just stop in the United States. The vast majority of them went to Central and South America. They went to the Caribbean, they went lots of places. And so I say Black to be inclusive of all my brothers and sisters who are of this, right? And if we really think about it, we're all African, like Burna Boy's mom said at BET Awards, because that's where they found the oldest human remains. But with all of that, I just have been increasingly empowered to sit as a Gen Xer in everything it means to be Black and to not apologize for it. That is what allows me to smile in a moment today. I think I had a moment yesterday to really process more like publicly in Instagram Live, I'm sorry, Facebook Live that I did with a pastor who's also a mental health professional. So the week has been, I just heard Dr. Blake talk about 1968. That's the same thing my dad said. My dad was like, baby, this ain't new. I remember this in 68 when I was, you know, just getting out of the Navy and we had been all over the world. And literally my dad said there were places he went in Europe where people will follow behind them because their peers who were their fellow sailors told people that Black people had tails. And so people are like, where's your tail? Like literally. Right. And this is right. And so when I think about things like the cardiovascular disease that Black people carry with them, a lot of Latinx populations who can also be Black, let's not forget, because Latinx is not a race. It's an ethnicity. And so when I think about all those things together, I'm always grateful for every day that I'm above ground, I'm healthy, and I have an opportunity to really be more of who I am. So as I shared, I'm a recovering academic. I said that before some people came on. And part of what that means is not allowing myself to fall into the traps of there are these theories and these ideas that we push forth. I'm a psychologist, as psychologists, that don't take into account racial ethnic diversity, that don't take into account what a queer person's experience is, whether they're white queer, whether they're black or brown queer. And so part of my job, I call it everybody has a purpose journey. Part of what also gives me good mental health is knowing that on my purpose journey, part of it is to disrupt people's thinking where we just accept what's been pushed to us, where we accept things like cognitive behavioral therapy works for everybody. We don't know that. It's never been tested with everybody. It's been tested with certain groups. And so part of what I come in to say is, we don't want to throw it all out, but we want to be mindful and accept that there are processes that we promote that we really don't know how those things work for different racial ethnic groups, particularly for those of us who are Black. But it's also true for other racial ethnic groups. And so I think about having a conversation over in the chat about some things that have that people that we promote and that we want to share with people, and we want to say that this is a guide, this is the way we can do this, it might be. But I think if we're not willing to accept that there are aspects of racial trauma, the experience of what it means to be a Black person in the United States or in Canada for that matter, but Black in some of these countries that are that don't have a lot of people of color in them or that are not predominated by Black people, if that's not part of our experience, I think it can often be very hard to understand what that day-to-day lived experience is. So what I say to people is, I don't want sympathy. I don't think Black people want sympathy. I think what we want is empathy. We want people to try to understand as much as possible what that experience is like. And I think if we can try to practice coming from a place of wanting to understand and being empathic and educating ourselves, right? I'm a heterosexual cisgender woman. I don't understand what it's like to be a queer Black person, a queer Black woman, right? And I'm gender conforming. I don't understand what that experience is like for a Black person who's non-gender conforming, but it's also not good for me, for that other person's mental health, for me to go ask them to teach me. That's not their responsibility. It's my responsibility to go find out as much as I can. And then if we're friends, to be able to engage in conversation. So I'm like James, I want some comrades. I want some people who are gonna come in and be prepared to move the process forward with me. Because I feel like if we come from that space, I wanna help, I wanna support, I'm going to do everything I can to come as well prepared as possible. We extend grace to that other person, the person who is experiencing the victimization, the person who is experiencing the racial trauma. In this case, we're talking about race. We extend grace to them to take one tiny thing off of their plate and give them space to sort of exist. What my wish for everybody's good mental health is that everybody has the opportunity and experience to go through life feeling like a fish in the water. That's my wish, right? So my experience at Howard with 4 years of my life where I swear to you, I felt like a fish in water. There has been no other time in my life when I've been outside my house, right? When I'm at home, I'm a fish in water. When I step out the door, hold them. So now let me clarify, at home, in my house with the TV off, where that stuff is not coming at me. That's when I feel like a fish in water. And my wish is that everybody had the opportunity to have that experience of feeling like a fish in water, which is why I love going to Jamaica. Because when I go to Jamaica, everywhere I go, I'm a fish in water. Everybody looks like me, right? And I have locks too. And so, you know, for my mental health and for all of our mental health, I think that empathy piece is really important. I think figuring out how do we, as Kelly teaches people, how do we function as good allies? I want you to see my color. I'm dark, so you can't miss it. So I want you to see, I want that to be good. I want that to be something we embrace. Just like I see yours, and I see your humanity, and I see your everything about you. And so those are the things that I think as I sit here, allow me to, you know, smile and not be so, not feel so heavy, because I have had opportunities to actively process as the week has gone on. So I don't want it to feel like for people in the midst of all of this, how could I not be? Because I had my moment yesterday or Thursday when I was just like, and so I got a lot of it out. But feeling your feelings, that's the other thing I want to say, is vital and critically important. And thank you for this space. Thank you all for holding space for the rest of us. I am deeply grateful.
I'm grateful for you always. Thank you. And for always sharing it so it's accessible and I feel like easy to take in and comprehend. It's so important. But yes, as Kelly Jackson said, being empathic would mean, or empathetic would mean that you have to abandon ego. And I feel like, how do you deal with gaslighting that happens right now? Where it's like, you're not hearing me. well, you're not here. It, like, I'm like, what? We can't even go anywhere. And I guess I want to throw this out to everyone here, including maybe someone like Dr. Blake, who has dealt with, you know, possibly finding peaceful mediation. How do you mediate when there's obviously someone in the wrong against human rights and someone that's like, clearly this is my lived experience. And then there's just gaslighting then that's happening and this like just misunderstanding, non-understanding, which is based around racism as well. How do you deal with that? And you're on mute, so I need to unmute you. Here, oh, just unmute yourself. There we go, just yeah, press that. Oh, maybe Nzinga needs to help. There we go, oh. Sorry, that was my bad. I muted him because we were, had, one sec, Zynga's gonna help. And I guess as Nzinga comes in, it helps. Kelly, do you want
to unmute? I'm sorry, I'm trying to unmute him, but it's saying ask.
You need to go inside. I think the his.
Yeah, I'm trying to do that.
And it no, go to where he's at and do it from there.
That's what I exactly, but it's just saying ask to unmute instead of like unmuting him.
Yeah, you need to go to where he is. Location.
Oh, okay. Hold on. Stand by.
Yeah, Kelly Jackson, do you want to? I mean, answer that in terms of. When you deal with those conversations happening in your Facebook groups?
I do. I tried. In fact, now the I lost.
Oh, there we go. First, we'll go to, all right, we'll go to Dr. Blake. There we go. You're good. Technology.
There we go.
Okay.
I won't unmute anyone now.
Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay. You know, I was listening so keenly to what everyone is saying, and it boils down to understanding the power of definition. Really, it was Toklika Michael who said that the utmost power somebody could have is that power to define who you are. Okay? And a lot of our problems, not just Black people, Hispanics, Native Americans, when you go across to Africa and other parts of the world, when the people in power define you without your ability to correct that definition, it becomes a problem. And the way we are treated, for example, the way the police people treat us, you could see that that definition of Black people that was historical, way, way back to Hegel and people like that, that we are brutes. Essentially, you're dealing with brutes. Mm. And when you deal with brutes, what do? You use lethal power. Okay? So that definition, we have not been able in a consistent manner to dismiss that definition. And socioeconomic conditions and other types of conditions tend to exacerbate our problems because some of us behave in ways that reify that definition. Brutality against ourselves. And people pick at it, oh, you see what I'm saying? These people, this is the way they are. And if we spend enough time, as Dr. Alfiee said just now, if we spend enough time trying to deal with that aspect. You have to accept me, I'm Black, I cannot escape it. But I also have to let you know what I understand by being Black, my position in society, my position in the world. This is why I approach these kinds of issues in a diasporic manner, as she does as well. So that power to define is so critical. And in my classes, what I do, I spend the first 3 weeks presenting the rhetorical construction of the African. How have we been defined? In this country and elsewhere, and how has that impacted upon the way we are treated? What have you done in terms of dismissing or really debunking that kind of definition? So every day in the life of an African, the life of a Black person, should be a teaching experience, self-teaching and teaching about others. Because you cannot get empathy if you really do not quite understand. Because the fundamental meaning is what? You're placing yourself in somebody else's shoes, right? To feel like that person. But if you do not know that person, you do not understand that person, you do not really realize how that person came to be the way it's projected, how do you get into his or her shoes? And this is where I indict the educational system. Because we've not been able to teach effectively other ethnicities what it means to be a Black person. We may teach it periodically, but it is not systematized. I recollect in the 70s, when we were trying to establish departments of Black studies in this country. Okay, in fact, we started with programs because so many major white universities were against the notion of a department. Because some of us argued that there has to be a symbiotic relationship between the academy and the Black community. Because in order for the academy to know, we need to get involved. We need to share. Talking about space, we have to occupy the space. They say, no, that's not the responsibility of the academy. And 76, 77, they threatened to close down all Black studies programs in this country. Because we're trying to educate, we're trying to sensitize. How else do you get empathy without that kind of situation? And let me come very quickly before I conclude. I remember we had a vicious war in Sierra Leone, a 10-year war, lost thousands of people. Lots of people got maimed. There were horrors committed, things that have never happened in our history. And so we're attempting to make peace. And the United Nations brought us together with rebels. And I was in the government delegation that dealt with negotiating with the rebels. And when I looked at these young men across, sitting across from us, and I asked myself, how much do these people really understand the extent to which we share so much similarity? Because the problem was, it was not an ethnic war. It was not a religious war. It was a war that lacked ideology. It was a stupid war over diamonds, it became eventually. So during the peace and conflict talks, what I used to do, I persuaded my colleagues, let's bring these young boys who call themselves generals and bring them here. Let's talk to them in our language. Let's talk to them using our warrants, because we share certain warrants that are common, regardless of ethnicity. And people used to be surprised when we get back to the negotiating table. You start seeing some shifts. Why? Because we're able to get to those other people, to share our common humanity, to share sort of a common culture. It may be in different ethnic groups, but there are a lot of similarities that we do not realize that we have. And we focus on the differences which really exacerbate conflict. So my question that I pose to Americans, how much do you really spend time and space in talking about similarities rather than the labeling that we get? I recognize that the labels are obstructive. But I don't know, maybe Dr. Alfiee, I don't know in your sessions the extent to which you approach this aspect of trying to look at similarities first and foremost. Of course, we're going to have differences, but is there any way we can build upon similarities as stepping stones towards effectuating empathy? I'm a layman in terms of psychology and things like that.
Yeah, absolutely, Sarah. I think we do. I think where we always try to start is particularly in session, the way we're trained, I could say how I was trained. Mm-hmm. We're trained to try to understand the points of synergy, because the points of synergy are what allow you to build the therapeutic relationship. Mm-hmm. I do think we start there. I think what often happens, though, is we stay there to the detriment of being able to fully recognize what's unique about the person that comes into therapy. And I think that's where people get upset, because they feel like they're made to feel invisible. You don't, this is so interesting. Like everything, like I know it has all kinds of problems. I'm gonna acknowledge that. But the Kung Fu Panda franchise, I love Master Oogway. I say this all the time. And one of the things that Master Oogway says in the movie is there are no accidents. And I think there's no accident that I just had this conversation trying to share with someone who's trying to put together an article about how people across racial ethnic groups in therapy can work better together. And so one of the things she asked was, but isn't it good to not discuss differences in therapy around race? I said, no, that's not good, because the race is in the room, right? Now, you have the experience of being all over the world and living in different places. My primary experience is in the United States. And in the United States, we spent so much time, I mean, you know this, you say you've been back and forth since 68. We spent so much time focused on similarity with the construct of similarity is there's a group that's here. The rest of you all need to get to where this group is, which is not similarity. Like you have to aspire to be more like us. Mm-hmm. I know that happens in all kinds of cultures. And I think that's where people get stuck. It is that there's no acknowledgement that we should meet here. What I feel like you're saying is we have to figure out a way to meet in the middle, to meet each other. And I think what frustrates people so much is, and I think this is any point of marginalization by a group that feels marginalized or that is marginalized, is that nobody, I always go back to this example of that I feel like a lot of people can wrap their heads around. I talk about men and women, or I talk about queer and not queer communities. We ask queer people, well, if y'all would just come up here with us, stop wanting to get married, stop wanting to have kids, right? Like if you would just come up here with us and listen to us tell you all the things that are wrong with you, then things would be easy. And I think what people are saying is, no, you just accept me for who I am. And our point of synergy is our shared humanity. We are humans. But it's so often that people feel like you can't see my humanness because you're too stuck on how I'm not like you. You want me to be like you. Like I have these conversations, especially around research and especially around theories and ways that we treat people. It's always, if you would just give this thing that I created with no people of color in mind, just take it over there and give it to the people of color. They'll love it, I promise. I'm like, but you got all these pieces that are missing. And so I agree with you. If we could find the shared humanity, something I always say to people is, our uniqueness is what unites us. Mm-hmm. And I teach my kids, everybody's different from everybody else. You don't say, oh, look at them people over there, they're different from me. No, you different from them too. Mm-hmm. We're all different from each other. Mm-hmm. And we're all unique. That's what makes us special. There's only one Dr. Blake. There's only one Nzinga Blake. There's only one Shearer. There's only one James in the way that you're created. So I believe in that deeply. I just think where we get lost is we don't have enough opportunity to also incorporate the conversation. I feel like it has to be a both and. We want to talk about our points of synergy, absolutely. And we want to learn the comfort. I don't want to monopolize the time, I'm looking at the clock. We want to build on people having a level of comfort talking about the things that make them unique. Everybody wants to be seen. That's why that book Invisible Man is so powerful.
Yeah.
Because it's about, you don't see me. Uh-huh. You don't see me, and I want you to see me. And then we can talk about our shared humanity, but we can't start with shared humanity and then you just ignore the fact that I'm Black and your experience and my experience is different. If somebody could just say we have a different experience, then okay, we're on the same page. Now let's have a conversation about what unites us. But I think too many people just lose that second part. They just want to stay on, we're just alike, let's just go from there.
Thank you, Dr. Alfiee. Yeah, and not just see here, can you hear me? You're seeing, I mean, it's all connected. Yes. Yeah, and I know Kelly Jackson wants to come in now. Well,
Dr. Alfiee, man, you're just on point all the time, all the time. I wanted to say that what I've noticed kind of from, you know, growing up in the ghetto of LA and being surrounded by my people, so that I had a comfort level there, but also going to school in white areas. What I've seen is that we have, as a society, we emulate celebrities. We have magazines that further push the agenda that we need to look all a certain way. And so there is nothing set up in society currently that supports uniqueness. There is nothing in society set up currently to support the differences that aren't really differences. The difference is just the color of skin. That's it. Mm-hmm. We are all more alike than we are different. We all essentially want the same things from life. Right. Why can't we get past seeing that? Why can't we celebrate that everybody's unique? I mean, to me, if we could all get together, the things we could accomplish is just astounding to me. Why do we still have an education system that teaches lies and conditions students? Why hasn't that been addressed? Why haven't even our own people? I have watched my son literally be demolished by the school system. I unschooled him this year. He has a learning disorder. And he was labeled as a behavior issue, and he was not. They refused to test him. All of the things they do to our Black children, to a point where he didn't want to try anymore because nothing he did was right. He wasn't able to catch on as quickly. Why don't we have more individualized education systems? We don't all learn the same. We don't all process information the same. Why do we have one system that essentially helps only one group of people? But we all have to attend that school. I can say over and over again, one of the things that I do in the Allies group is I invoke questions that allow our members to answer in a way that shows that we're more similar than we are different. And I think once we start to accept just human beings in general, without the label, I mean, I feel like if we all could walk around with bags on our head and cover our skin, you wouldn't know a lot of times that you were speaking to, a certain ethnic group, unless there's an accent or what have you. My point being is that it just seems very simple to me, and I'm not sure why this is still happening and people are still continuing to believe nonsense. I mean, we're now in a society where fact-checking is something you have to do. And if you don't, you're believing stuff that is just not true. And you're using it to further push an agenda that supports systemic racism. So I pray we all can get it together. I know we have a lot of allies in our group. One of the things that I love, and I know people have a problem with that, but I got some down allies in my group. And I love being able to have these conversations in a safe space between allies and our Black members that allow them to be corrected, to allow us to say, look, you're gaslighting. Look, you're centering. This is what you're doing. I know you don't mean to. I know you're not intentionally doing it, but this is what it is. Take it or leave it. Go look it up in a book. Go see a therapist. You'll figure out quickly enough that what I'm saying is not a lie. So I have, I have allies that take it. We tell them, this is not a space for your sensitivity or your weakness. This is a place for you to put your big girl panties on and get it together. You have a lot of white mothers now with biracial children that aren't teaching their children correctly. And we're just perpetuating this system that's not designed for us and not doing anything to break it down. So my hope and prayer in all of this is that we have 10,000 members and that we build a bridge essentially to allow white people to get to a point where they can teach other white people what's going on. Because white people don't really want to hear it from us. They want to hear us or look at us or emulate us, but they don't want to listen to us. They don't want to hear what we have to say. There's a big difference in that. So, living that experience is one thing. Understanding somebody else's experience is paramount in today's, today's age. It just is. There's no room for that anymore.
Perfect segue. Shout out to the white mamas raising biracial kids. I am one of them. You know, my mom is, I was telling Dr. Blake before here, I was raised in the 70s by a white mother who was in the movement, was involved with the Panther movement. My father ran with the Panthers, probably where you get a lot of my angst against the word allies, and is having a mom who didn't let me slack and raised me as a black man, you know, and so I really appreciate that. And so on that, I just want to segue. We've been hearing from a lot of black people, and I do that all day long. I actually love to hear from folks who aren't black, no disrespect to my brethren, but I'd love to hear from folks that aren't black. And how are you?
I know that Dr. Blake wanted to say something. I mean, coming up.
Oh, okay.
Quickly, and then it's hard to see who wants to talk, but
yeah.
And then if you're ready, yeah, whoever wants to talk,
yeah,
talk. Do you want to add something?
Whoever specifically though, I'd love to hear from people who aren't black, just because we've been talking a lot and we talk a lot all the time.
I just wanted to say something very, very briefly. You know, the points that Kelly raised, the way I have taught mainly in predominantly white institutions, okay, mainly. And I have been able to communicate with white people, okay? I have attended conferences in which some white people in powerful positions come to me and say, thank you, Professor Blake, you changed my life. I'm serious.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it's the manner, the pedagogical style, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, secondly, we live in a society that thrives on division.
That's right.
Okay, this is a society that it's historical. And when you thrive on division, the people who have the power, they will try to tell you even not just how to see yourself, but how not to behave. Something happened in Britain this past weekend, which was tooted here a few days ago. Now they're saying that the curriculum should not include anti-racist information. Don't teach anything that would highlight anti-racism. Don't teach anything that would highlight the importance of cooperation rather than rugged competition.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the nature of the society itself. And this is our own role then. How do you occupy that space to let people understand this nature of the system without them being frightened? Okay, that look, you know, this popular thing that's a cliche now, we're all in this together and all of that kind of stuff. It's a cliche, but it's a very powerful cliche. And these kinds of issues we're addressing, people have to realize that it's not just black people or people of, in quotes, I hate that word, people of color. I really don't like it. I don't like that expression. But it's all of us who will suffer, including white people. So the more we teach cooperation and let people understand the power of cooperation, I think the more it's possible for us then to reduce these kinds of tensions. I just wanted to make that quick interjection.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
And I think what Kelly said
Rick
also.
I think Rick is raising his hand.
Oh yeah, Rick, okay. And then, all right, yes, Rick.
Yeah. First of all, I want to say I feel privileged listening to the different voices here. And I've sat through other Zoom conferences where I've heard people tell their stories about their experiences of racism. And I really appreciate Dr. Blake starting off by saying how he felt scared. And then every time people were telling their stories, which was more about them personally rather than our programs and what we can do here, that, and whatever, that to me is the most powerful thing that affects me. And when I've sat through those things, what I have found missing was the if you did a reverse fishbowl where you had white people reacting to the stories that they heard, and then you come back again, and then you have the other group speak about their reactions to what they heard. And I think, you know, how do you create sort of collaborative communities that are able to enhance understanding of a commonality, but we still have to appreciate our diversities as well. So how do we do both? And I don't know whether people have had that experience. I felt missed out when I sat through other things where I felt like I needed to speak about my reactions and the pain that I heard in their stories and my reactions to them with other white folk and see how they're reacting. Mm-hmm. And I just think that might be a way of, you know, what James was talking about, going beyond allyship. I sort of had that mixed feeling myself about the word, and it's difficult to come up with something else. Accomplice doesn't work, coalitions doesn't work. You know, if you can come up with a new word that is stronger than ally, but gets the point of how we come together to be able to raise our voices and our common humanity. You know, that's what. So I just want to say I appreciated the stories, and I'd love to be able to involved in more discussions like this.
I just wanted to respond to you. Thank you, Rick, for your comments. Interestingly enough, my kids, we lived in Atlanta, Georgia, which I find to be a city that actually does do really well with holding space for really tough conversations. My kids went to a wonderful school called the Paideia School in Atlanta, and they used to have this thing called the fishbowl, where they would put all of the Jewish kids, all of the Muslim kids, all of the Black kids in an actual center, and folks would actually lean in and watch the conversations. And I just always thought it was a really beautiful way for young people to understand exactly what you said in practice, the idea of an actual fishbowl, where you can, you know, where we can listen and we can lean in and find this place of empathy, and to go against any division. I love that thought. And yes, I'm intentionally antagonistic around the word allies for a purpose, because I want to get beyond the signs were beautiful during the Black Lives Matter marches. They were wonderful. And yes, the acknowledgement of Juneteenth was cool, but we're at a point where we need to look at this as war. And though I use the word comrade strongly, and I know it might rise some of you, we need to look at this as war, because those that are against us are looking at it as war. And so I use that language with intentionality, because we are in a heightened state that we need to be aware of. That's all.
Yeah. Well, let me quickly react to that. I think the reverse fishbowl is also important, but just to come back to your metaphor of war, I understand where that's coming from, but actually I let me just say what my issues are with that, which is that to me, that metaphor tends to, I'm not sure it's the best metaphor for actually reducing the divisiveness that we're dealing with. And everyone's heard, you know, being called a social justice warrior used to be considered like a cool thing, but it's now been flipped by the right, who see it, oh, you're just a social justice warrior. You know, the valence of the word has changed. And I what I would prefer to call myself is an equity peacemaker, because if you put equity at the forefront, it's more about peacemaking than making war. Now, that doesn't mean to say you have to be a hard ass and you have to advocate, but I'm just, I have some reluctance to using war metaphors when I think peace metaphors may actually give us longevity, better longevity.
I would love to know, and like I know James, and like what MLK has said, writing is the voice of the unheard. And that is true. I think there is some triggers around the word war. And I think that probably comes from probably the white people, because the worry is like, is this gonna get the change to happen? And then I think people that are experiencing this are like, yes, obviously, like what other choice do we have? We have been trying to get heard for so long.
Right.
So like, can we talk about that?
If I could jump into that, this is a conversation that I have with my father a lot, because, I tell him, I'm like, you're a communications expert. I really wish that we could get more people to hear your thoughts, because words really do matter. Yeah. And so Daddy, I don't know if you could speak up to some of the conversations we've had, you know, over the past couple of weeks about rhetoric becoming reality. And I love, remember Shira, you were even in that discussion.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So mm-hmm. Daddy, do you want to speak to that?
Well, I do, but you know, I'm just thinking about the time.
We're going to be done. I mean, and you could obviously drop off whenever you need to. I just think that this is really important. And like, as we're all like, the, when we talk about allies, accomplices, co-conspirators, and I'm whatever I need to be to make a change happen, right? And so I will fight alongside, and this is a fight. Though I get scared about war too, and maybe it's the Canadian in me, you know what I mean? I get worried, right? When you start using the word war, even though something has to happen, because the status quo isn't working.
Yeah, I think it's important to note that people are out there ready to die for this. You know, I mean, I use that on purpose. Totally. And so, I just think it's important to note where we are right now. And the young people, not us, we are, you know, the young people who may not want to vote. You know what I mean? Like if this continues, we're at a place, I'm not trying to cause fear and scare anybody tonight, but Portland, we had a whole episode on Portland here on The Other America. You know, think of what's happened in Portland since that episode that we did. So I just think, you know, I just want to raise the level of awareness. That's all.
And it is true. Yeah, well,
the metaphor of the, I am also a little bit uncomfortable with the metaphor of the war. And that fear, in a way, because you travel the world, you see the world is at war in so many, many ways, not just between countries, between regions. And this is where my daughter is talking about the rhetoric and how we shape, how our language shapes these kinds of situations. In fact, it is this kind of rhetoric that pushed me into a series of, in fact, writings. I have a major publication on peace communication, that we have to begin to look at how we use peace communication to avert the kinds of wars that, you know, are threatening us. So this perhaps is for another session, but it's an extremely important thing. If James is seeing this as warfare, then we need to look at balances, because you don't go to war where you can be completely annihilated, you know, wiped out. So this for me is right now the problematic. If you see that as war, somebody is willing to die for it, you're talking practically about martyrdom. For what purpose? In Islam, martyrdom is for you to go to heaven, right? Now, for what purpose will this war, when you're saying somebody is willing to die for it? You look at the system that we have. Look at what has just happened with the appointment of 6 conservative jurists, the highest level of justice in this country. How are you going to fight that war? There are some ways, unless you want to use it as fighting for something rather than dying for something, then I could perhaps understand that metaphor. But to tell young people right now that they have to die for something, I think it's really, I don't know.
And I'm just expressing I'm expressing the sentiments I get from the generations, the younger generations who aren't here, right? And there is a scary, I agree with you. I'm about peace. And I actually put in the chat room, we should do a session on peace communications, right? And even make this a wider, younger, more diverse group of people, because I think you're right. And I only raise that because I am concerned like you, and I am scared like you. And I am not about to kill anybody. No, I'm here as a lover but I bring to you the sentiments from Chicago, right? I bring to you the sentiments from other communities where voting is just not an option.
It's real, James. It's real. And I think about what happened in Nazi Germany. I would be fighting in that war, right? Like, we are going back, you know, we're in that time again. So I think about it like that in terms of that. And I'm willing to go out, if that's what it takes to get change, I'm willing to do it. I'm willing to be side by side with my friends and family for
equality. Well, I'm definitely willing to protect my community. That part is true.
And I'm worried about the rhetoric, the narrative and the rhetoric. That's then what worries me. Yeah. And where do we go from here? And what does that actually mean, right? Because it's scary. Then we're getting into civil war. Then we're getting into a place where the divisiveness continues, and where do we land? Does that lead to a solution? I don't know. But then I look towards people like Dr. Blake, who has created other options and possibilities that lead to change. And I wonder if that's possible.
We should illuminate his voice and figure out a way to, you know, move into action. So, yeah, you know, and I'd love to do that.
Does anyone have anything else to say? I know that we're hanging out here this Sunday, and I know that Dr. Alfiee needs to leave soon as well, but we'd love to hear from anyone else to jump in. Since we are a smaller group, let us know. Put your hand. Oh, we appreciate you for being here. I just put my audio on mute. Does anyone
Rick would like to say something. Rick would like to say something.
Yeah, quick question for Dr. Blake, actually, and it feeds off James's suggestion. How far are you on your journey in terms of developing platforms, programs, whatever, about peacemaking? Because I think language is critically important, and how do you actually cultivate, how do we reach the younger generation that feels that it has to go to war and die for the cause and say there is another way, just in the spirit of Martin Luther King? I don't know. I'd love to know if there's something out there.
See, the thing is this, that my platform has been mainly academia.
Yeah.
I said mainly, okay. But there have been other sessions. This whole aspect of looking at alternative African futures.
Yeah.
All right. Where war is gradually, taking over peaceful ways of solving issues.
Yeah.
You know, I've had symposia in my home in Freetown that deal with this particular issue of looking at the alternatives, looking at what is extant, and then looking at the alternatives.
Yeah.
So it's been piecemeal. Now I'm retired, but extremely active. You know, I'm a visiting professor right now in West Africa, and still use the academy, because my hope is that when I get to these young people, the undergraduate students, and show them these kinds of options, that there would be potential multiplier effect.
Mm-hmm.
Potential, I keep emphasizing potential, because by the time they get out of the university, it's not just in West Africa, it's also here, they become attracted to money. And they forget some of these things.
Yeah, exactly.
So how do you keep the youth as activists?
Yeah, well, I just like to put a plug in for Jay's work, because I think universities is too late. I mean, this is something we should be really inculcating into our learning systems at a young age.
I agree.
It has to be something, and we don't teach kids the important stuff about life in school. They learn a lot of stuff that isn't relevant.
Rick, I'll send you a clip. That's precisely what I said in that clip.
Yeah.
That we have to get them before.
Exactly.
And Dr. Alfiee, Aakoma Project, just before you leave, please share what you're doing, because you are working with young people.
Yeah.
Yes, thank you. So the most important thing is I have learned, this is just, I'm speaking as an N of one. I don't pretend to speak for anybody but me, is we have to listen,
yeah.
Right? If mm-hmm. James is telling us that what young people are talking about is, well, he's right. That is what these kids are talking about.
Yeah.
And we can't communicate with these kids effectively if we do, I'm Gen X, what most of us Gen X and older do, which is,
yeah,
that's what we do,
yeah,
right? We don't listen to these kids. But I'm telling you from my experience, and that's what young people tell us. So the ones that they're happy to sit with are literally the ones who do something as basic as sit and be quiet. I'm not even kidding. If we can sit and listen to what the kids have to say, it's all about joining. That's one of the things I appreciate so much about being a mental health professional, is that you learn how to, those skills are not just for, I tell people, these are life skills. Mm-hmm. Active listening is a thing. Summarizing what the person has said to you before you speak back to them.
Mm-hmm.
What I heard you say is blah, 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 as opposed to, well, you know, I think so-and-so, so-and-so, so-and-so. Because what the person hears is, you're not listening to me. And they shut down, yeah, or they get argumentative. Yeah. And so I think I was taught this a long time ago by a psychologist. I have so much respect for her. It's a Latina, her name is Dr. Maya McNeely. And she taught me, I know it's an old saying, but she said, seek first to understand. You need to understand what you're hearing. Then you want to be understood. Yeah. And once you communicate to the other person that you understand what they're saying, then I think you can really sort of build relationship. But if I say, for example, I believe in X, and the response I get is, oh, well, I believe in Y. You haven't heard anything I've said. While I'm talking, you're thinking about what's coming out of your mouth, that you're not listening to me. And indeed. So for me, with the coma, what we really, I really had to learn the hard way. Those kids don't care about what I have to say until I demonstrate that I'm listening to what they have to say.
Exactly.
So that's what we do with the coma. Everything is built. We have a youth advisory board. And I'm not saying we always get it right. Sometimes we have to chase the kids down to get them to be responsive because they got other stuff going on. We're not their priority. But I think the most important thing for me is going back to, if I hear James say, I'm a warrior, I'm a social justice warrior, whatever the terminology was, I'm a warrior, we're at war. And he's saying that's what the kids are saying. Then when I go to sit down with the kids, I'm walking in the door thinking, okay, these kids are ready for war. And so how do I have a conversation with them about war, then unpack war a little bit and say, well, baby, if you're approaching it from a perspective of war, maybe these are some things to consider.
Yep.
Have you thought about that? And they're like, oh man, I ain't never think about it like that. Someone will burst into tears. And then let's say things like, you know, you're the first person who has ever actually listened to me.
Exactly.
And I'm not even really doing anything. And so I think I get frustrated and get amped up when I hear people doing this. Mm-hmm. We're not having conversations with each other. We're mm-hmm. like, I'm not saying this whole group. I'm saying often in these kinds of spaces, we don't have conversations with each other. And I tune out. I stop. Like, I don't have any mental energy or emotional labor if I'm not being listened to. And that's what happens with young people. That's how we lose them. They don't come back. They vote with their feet. They just don't come back. And so I think part of it really is, what are the ways in which we can sort of, I'll speak for myself, going back to what Kelly said earlier, how can I take my ego, stick it on the shelf, and just be quiet, right? And sit on my hands and be uncomfortable when they're saying stuff. I'm like, oh my God, I can't believe you said that. Like, fix my face. I don't have a poker face. just right? And just pay attention, right? The fortunate thing with Zoom, I can turn the camera off. So most of the time when my camera's off, I'm not happy. But I don't want to put that into the conversation because that's not what people are here for. They're not here to make me comfortable. I got to manage my own stuff. So I think for me, it's really about how do we create space for our young people to feel like they're being listened to. Because I don't think they hear us. I'll speak again for me. Mm-hmm. I know they don't hear me if I don't demonstrate that I'm willing to listen to them. And the way I demonstrate I'm willing to listen is trying to understand where they're coming from before I ever say anything.
Dr. Alfiee, let me assure you that as a professor of communication, okay, and this is something I've published as a matter of fact, the importance of listening.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay. I'm a professor of communication, spent my entire academic life dealing with that. So I'm not saying that we should not listen. In fact, that is the most important step to understand a phenomenon. Okay. And we teach people how to listen. Okay. So the concern that I had about the matter of the war, it was not multifaceted. It was stated that you should die for something. Mm-hmm. All right? Now, this is why I use the metaphor of peace. That doesn't mean that you are not listening. No professor or no lecturer that's worthy of his profession or his education would downplay the importance of listening to what people are saying, even of more significance. Of listening to what the young people are saying. And if much earlier on, I spoke about pedagogical style. Not everybody has the same pedagogical style. You know, I privilege pedagogical styles that are interactive, that are extractive, because without that, you're not going to get an understanding of what is going on.
So I agree.
Please, I don't want you to leave this forum thinking that some of us don't teach listening. It's an extremely important part of communication. It's an extremely important part of pedagogy. It's an extremely important part of peace and conflict resolution. Because if you cannot listen, how are you going to make peace?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. I agree 100%. I agree 100%. And with all due respect, what I'm saying, what I'm hearing, is you talking about the centrality of listening as a concrete and necessary facet of building peace. That's what I'm hearing. And I think we agree 100%. Yes. And your work, all of your work in communication has really been about that aspect. So on that point, I would say we agree 100%. And my hope, so full stop, I agree with that 100%. And my hope is that all of us can, as you just articulated, can embody that in our behavior as well as with our words. I think sometimes, right, coming from institutions, I don't even need to name them, it doesn't matter, where there are people who will say that that those are qualities that they believe in and then don't practice it at all. And I think what you're saying is anybody worth their salt is going to both say it and they're going to practice it. Because, and I think for many marginalized folks, they have the experience of hearing the words a lot. People know the buzzwords and just failing to practice honestly in a way that demonstrates and say, everybody's gonna make mistakes, but failing to consistently have that as a practice with listening being the grounding. So I started off saying you have only my respect, because if it wasn't for a Dr. Blake, there would be no Dr. Breland-Noble in these at a Duke or a Georgetown or a Howard or, you know, Pittsburgh or wherever. So I think that with respect, I hear what you're saying. And I feel like I don't want to leave with anybody thinking I haven't heard you. I think that, not just you, sir, I think that for all of us, it's this listening piece of key.
Yeah. No, the Japanese have something that we lived in Japan for 6 years. And when you say something to the Japanese, it says, hi. That means yes, but it doesn't mean I understand you. And a lot of miscommunication occurs in that, this is where the listening thing becomes important. Somebody says yes, yes, but do you understand what I'm trying to say?
Yes.
As we wrap, as I know everyone, we said we can continue this forever because it's such an important and needed conversation. And even in that, by the way, Dr. Alfiee, thank you for enlightening me and reminding me as a friend and someone that we work alongside each other, because even in that, I get scared and triggered and I'm like, please don't use that word. And then without saying, wait, tell me more, right? Make me understand. Exactly. So thank you. That was like the most beautiful lesson for me today. I'm gonna get emotional because it's a reminder of why I do this, these conversations, because I always learn, there's always space to learn. Mm-hmm. So thank you for your honesty also. Oh God, all right. I'm like about to cry. Okay, there's always like a cry moment in here. And to Dr. Blake for everything that you're doing, which is so needed right now, because it is scary. I'm scared. I'm asked every day if I should go back to Canada. You know what I mean? Like, I don't want to go back to Canada. I just like many, I dreamed of growing up here, or I mean, going to school here and raising a family here. And the fact is that that's a question now, and it hurts me. It hurts to see my friends hurting. And I wanna work alongside them to make a difference. And it feels overwhelming as every day, and I cover the news, and maybe that's why I'm like a bit even more emotional. Like, it feels hard. It feels like I'm scared no matter what we do, I'm worried. That's it. All right, that's my kind of, moment today. That was my vulnerable moment on a lack of sleep and covering the news every single day. You know, it's difficult. And I can't imagine being someone who's more impacted, you know, living it. I'm just like on the sidelines, you know, or so thank you. And whatever I can do to support all of you as well. I try to do it. That's it. Anyone else have anything to say? Oh yes, Jay Quigley, and I know we have to wrap. And Nzinga.
Well, as a listener, I'm deeply honored to be in everybody's company here and hear this and be part of this session. I agree with James that peace communications would be excellent. I have a friend who was active in CORE early on, and they did a lot of work around white people going out to bring black people together with white people in one of their spaces. And when the the Lloyd protest began, and the Lloyd that happened, myself and a couple and some of my Black friends, we had a pretty fairly deep conversation about appropriate responses and ways to go. And one of the themes that emerged was the need, the actual need for white people who were isolated from Blacks to experience them. And what were the organizations doing about saying, I'm going to call the local Rotary Club, or I'm going to call this group or that, or the, and bring in a group of people. Let's have a joint conversation under maybe open circle rules or something like that. Mm-hmm. And I think that's an important element to be developed going forward, setting up those conversations. So out of our chat, one of the things that was recommended is to create a TV show for news stations where you're having those dialogues well moderated and between the what seems to be the clashing communities, so that there's a sense of that value of understanding another person, really being able to listen to another person, hear their life circuit, and see especially the quality and understand the quality of life experiences of most of the Black people in
America. And Jay, I want to just bring in, as we wrap things up, Nzinga, who's been our amazing co-host and brought in Dr. Blake, who's his daughter. But she's done Emmy award-winning producing shows around this topic. So I want to bring her in as we wrap things up.
Oh, that's great. Well, they told me they're going to work on it. And if we put it, I'll hook you up. I brought one of the fellows into the early meetings here.
I think what you're saying is 100%, because as I had said earlier, the news doesn't have time to invite community voices, to highlight community voices. And with the work that I've done and I'm still doing, it is about really amplifying the voice of the community, because what the news has done in the past is they tell the stories of the people. And so now with digital media, which I think is so great, and in a lot of news, media outlets are really using these platforms to tell, like, you know, to highlight the voices of the people. There's a lot of work to be done. You know, it's not going to be overnight, but you can, you know, there's race and culture divisions coming up in a lot of different media outlets, which is very exciting. So it's going to happen. And we just hope, again, like I told everybody at Tribune, I said, my hope is that when we create these stories, these short form documentaries, we want people to listen. And we also want to spark the curiosity of people in our communities, because there's that amazing story. Quote, curiosity is the cure to ignorance. If we can get people in our communities to start asking, why are these things happening? You know, instead of just making preconceived notions about why someone got shot or what, you know, things like that. So that's what we're working towards.
All right. Well,
he's saying something.
Okay, you need to unmute yourself and then, yeah.
All right. Put your information. These are some people who are close to the entertainment industry and know what they're doing. And okay. I actually think it could be a fairly high rated show.
We've been talking. Zing and I have been even talking.
We've been working on it. Yeah.
Send me information. Let me put you together. Put it in this.
We will. And I just wanted to say, because I know I want to be respectful of people's time. And James, as we wrap things up, just like, I know Dr. Alfiee had to leave. She actually said it to me before I shared everything. So we appreciate her. And we're going to be sending everyone an email with everyone's links and everything, so you can follow and keep in touch. I want to do some final words, because Kelly, like Dr. Blake, just any final words as we wrap things up?
I just want to thank you for inviting me to this. You know, as I said at the beginning, I was looking forward to learn a lot, and I did. I just want to let you know that I did. And I'm looking forward to revisiting this recording. Thank you so very much. And I thank everybody in the panel, all of those who have made interventions. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Dr. Blake.
Thank you, Dr. Blake.
Amazing work you do. Kelly.
Yes, I just want to say thank you. Thank you to everyone here. Thank you for recognizing that this needs to happen. And I appreciate all of you and all of the work that you're doing. If I can ever be of support to anybody, please find me. I'm here. Shira, thank you for the work that you are doing and your persistence. I'm sending love and light to you all. Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity to be here. I learned a lot as well.
Thank you, Kelly. I'm giving you a big virtual hug. I feel like I would cry on your shoulder right now. For real. Mwah. And then Nzinga, do you want to just say any, I mean, you did say some final words as a co-host, and then I'll go to James.
Just thank you to everybody. Thank you again. I've always wanted to do something like this with my dad. So Shira, again, Shira's always the one who's like, need to do it, let's do it.
The beginning of many moments.
Yes, exactly. Thank you. Thank you to all the speakers and all the guests who've shared. I appreciate it.
James. Well, these conversations are not easy. When we, Shira and I decided to create this space, you know, it was right after George Floyd, and we anticipated, you know, more challenging weeks ahead. And as predicted, they've been really challenging. And I just thank all of you for, you know, taking your time on Sunday. I know it's really busy. As I mentioned, we're going to shift the time around. This is challenging even for us as producers. We want to make this and accommodate this for you guys. We've been doing this for, I don't know how long, 4 months. I don't know. It's been a long time. Not long enough. And clearly we have a lot more work to do. But we're here for you. We're here to support. I know some of these conversations are hard. That's why we introduced meditation and breath work. Cause it's really difficult, to talk about some of these things. And we'd encourage you to bring your friends, bring different viewpoints. We're here for all viewpoints, all thoughts. This is, you know, this is a space that we hope we can bring lots of different people. We also want younger people. That was the other thing that was a big takeaway for me today is, you know, no disrespect to any of our ages, but it'd be great to have some younger voices to hear from another generation. Because, you know, I tend to speak from that generation, even though I'm 50, I still think like an 18-year-old girl. So mainly because I'm raising one. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your commitment. And, you know, my prayers and my light and love go out to all of you this week. It's going to be a really challenging week, and we're here for you. So thank you.
Thank you. And usually as we wrap this up, everyone can say goodbye, but we hang out and as everyone leaves, me and James. So if anyone wants to continue chatting or saying something, bye Nzinga, I love you. You can. We'll send an update with an email. Bye, Dr. Blake. Thank you so much. Beautiful week. Thank you, Kelly. And nice to see some faces.
Thank you, guys. Your mama is still on.
This is my mom on Yom Kippur night.
Yom Kippur. Comes out.
Thank you, Lucas.
Thank you, Shira.
See you.
Bye.
Oh, bye, Dr. Bill. Bye, I love you.
Nice to see you. See you.
Yeah.
Of course, we'll have you, Kelly. Definitely come back. Kelly, yes, where do you live?
Your thoughts, by the way.
Kelly, where do you live?
I'm in Los Angeles.
Okay, you're LA too.
Yeah, we need to do more. We should do like a whole group one, like when more time to organize and.
Yeah, I'm totally down. I do unpackings now every Monday and Wednesdays because okay. I'm finding that, you know, the information in the group is great. The conversations are there. What I've started practicing when I see allies and yeah, what I'm noticing is that these allies can be super aggressive when they're here in their journey and you have a new ally that isn't really aware of the complexities of everything. Sure. So we had to kind of step that back. I'm like, you're still centering yourself if you're saying that you're above someone else. And I know you mean well, but you have to recognize. And I think it's just some of those little microaggressions that we're kind of used to doing. And it hasn't really been taught or called out. So I know for me personally, I tend to have a little more patience because I know people just don't know and it's not excusable anymore. So we've now provided a place for you to know. And that's your choice if you want to know or not to know.
Yeah, I've done better at that too. Trust me, I tend to get in that place where I'm like, I have a hard time and I'm like, really? And I did this anti-racist workshop or classes with I wonder if you know him and I should send you David something. He's like really known. I wanted to bring him in this conversation. Maybe we do something together and bring him in.
He does
amazing work and really makes you understand how to confront it and work through it, because that's where change happens. And like, I do think in the social justice warrior side, as a white person, you get so to the point where you're like, you're not taking advantage of your privilege to make a difference. You're just like going in and you're not gonna, like the conversations aren't happening.
Yeah.
And it's hard. And like, yeah, it's a challenge. And I don't want to leave it to my Black friends or POC friends, because that's not their job. But then we get to like, if that's our hard work, maybe it's not that hard, right? Like,
I think that it's really important. I know that I have Black friends that don't necessarily agree with my stance on, you know, embracing.